If positive material identification is important to you, and it should be, stay tuned and we'll show you three exciting methods of how to check and verify plastic resins. Hello, this is Gordon Stiles, the founder and CEO of Star Rapid, and I've been involved in rapid prototyping and new product development for more than 37 years. And I'm happy to welcome you to another episode of Serious Engineering for Serious Engineers.
Serious Engineering.
Captioned here are seven black plastic boxes. Even to the practiced eye, each of these boxes looks pretty much the same, but they are in fact different materials, each with its own unique chemical and physical properties. So today's challenge is to find out which is which, and we're going to do that by exploring how positive material identification, or PMI, works. Now, of course, every product developer needs to be sure that they are using exactly the material they specified for plastic injection molding, CNC machining, or any other process you wish to use. This affects more than just a part's performance, durability, and cost. There are also legal requirements, such as with REACH and RoHS regulations in Europe, to demonstrate that plastic products don't contain the 10 banned hazardous substances from lead all the way through to diisobutyl phthalate, or is that phthalate? Well, we'll never know, will we? There is also a huge amount of fake and or non-conforming materials that have permeated the global supply chain, so everyone needs to be on guard. Given the importance of material verification, we're amazed that PMI is still something overlooked by many suppliers, or it's done in a slipshod fashion. This might be because it takes a lot of time and effort, requires skilled and well-trained staff, and it means a pretty substantial investment in equipment. In fact, before the advent of scientific and computerized metrology, there were other ways experienced engineers had for identifying resins, but they were a bit haphazard. For example, one of the most common methods was the melt flow index test, or MFI, where you melt plastic pellets in a barrel, 230 degrees centigrade for polypropylene, for example. Then you put a plunger of a known weight on top, maybe 2.16 or 5 kilograms, and force the melt through a 2 millimeter diameter hole for 10 minutes. And that's your measure. How many grams came out in 10 minutes? And you'll find this data published in many technical data sheets. You could even burn some resin and smell the telltale fumes that were produced. But please, kids, don't do this at home. I really picked a bad day to give up sniffing glue. At Star, we still perform tensile and impact tests, scratch tests, and we can even measure the specific gravity and density. Again, all of these methods can give you useful information, but they're not always practical, they take a long time to set up and perform, and they're all destructive to one degree or another. That's why when you need reliable and repeatable results for testing plastic resins in a modern manufacturing environment, there is no substitute for performing routine chemical and physical analysis using modern scientific equipment. Fortunately, there are some inherent characteristics of all physical elements that can be cleverly exploited by sophisticated test equipment to yield accurate results. Let's take a look at three of the most common methods of positive material identification and RoHS testing for plastic resins, their advantages and drawbacks. X-ray fluorescence. Now this gun, which costs about $35,000, is normally used for PMI on metals, but it can also be used to find the four RoHS banned substances of lead, cadmium, mercury, and chromium. It can also see any other metals that might be lurking around in your plastics that shouldn't really be there. We cannot, however, see the difference between trivalent and hexavalent chromium. So you'd have to go to a lab and get a far more sophisticated test performed if you do find chromium where it shouldn't be. In the XRF process, high energy X-rays or gamma rays bombard the target surface. These rays interact with the electrons in the outermost orbit of the atoms of the sample, causing them to fluoresce or emit a photon. This photon has an energy signature that's unique for each element in nature. All elements fluoresce under X-rays, but this XRF gun is not powerful enough to see carbon. This gun can also penetrate beneath the surface of the sample and can even see what is under a thin decorative plated surface, for example. If you know that your plating contains copper, nickel, and chrome, any other metal that shows up, well, it might be in the plastic substrate. For example, we often check for real gold on gold plated contacts, but we also see the elements that make up the brass that's underneath. Among the benefits of XRF is that it's portable and non-destructive, so it can be used on finished parts or in the field with minimal sample preparation or damage. Laser spectrometry. Here, a monochromatic laser beam of known frequency and energy is emitted, such as with this near-infrared Polymax testing gun. A large percentage of the light will be reflected unchanged back to the detector. However, some of the light interacts with the molecules of the sample. When it does so, the light changes its energy state and produces a unique waveform that is characteristic for that material. This is known as Raman spectroscopy, which was invented by a gentleman of the same name, a Mr. CV spectroscopy. The analyzer then compares this waveform to its internal database of known materials, yielding results of approximately 70% accuracy. This is normally good enough for simple field testing when you don't want to damage the part. The reason we can't guarantee 100% reliability is because the detector can be blocked by dirt on the sample or the lens, or due to incidental light leaking in from the ambient environment. We can also calibrate for a specific resin using one of our 300 or so golden samples. More on that later. Also, as with the XRF method, it helps to do multiple tests in a row. This is done to establish both the accuracy of the reading and its precision or repeatability. Now we get to the big guns. Fourier Transform Infrared Spectroscopy. There's that guy again. We use our Fourier Transform Infrared, or FTIR for short, when we want a very high degree of accuracy and precision on PMI of plastics. Our Bruker Alpha FTIR, for example, can routinely produce results of 98% accuracy or better against a database of known chemical spectra. It works on the principle that most molecules absorb light in the infrared and convert this into molecular vibration measurable by its wavelength. Therefore, the instrument puts out infrared radiation and analyzes the resulting wavelength patterns. The beauty of the Alpha is that it transmits in many frequencies and does so very quickly. This means that it can check all of the spectral data at once, rather than one frequency at a time, which was common in the past. We calibrate the Bruker Alpha using one of our 337 golden samples that we've sourced from all over the world directly from the manufacturers. I cannot tell you how much work that's been the last 5 years, all with the intention of protecting my company and ultimately you as the product developer from receiving and using fake and/or non-conforming resins. And don't forget, in many cases, a certificate is pretty much worthless. We currently carry 291 different plastic resins, so you can imagine that we must be extremely careful about PMI. One other interesting issue about our FTIR is that when we're trying to measure very dark or black plastics, they're often filled with what is called carbon black, which is literally made of carbon. The problem is that we cannot reliably inspect black resins because we use a diamond lens, which of course is made of carbon, so its signature is filtered out of the results. So when we're doing black resins, we switch out the diamond lens for a germanium lens. And to do this, we switch out the entire front end of the device, as you can see here. Now, back to our little black boxes. What does the Polymax gun say? Now you can see why you shouldn't settle for less than positive material identification for all of your projects. If you found this to be useful information, please share the engineering love. Give us a like, ding the bell, stay tuned for the next episode when we're going to discuss PMI of metals. And don't forget, we're the people that do serious engineering for serious engineers.
Serious Engineering.